Yang saya hormati Wakil Perdana Menteri Singapura
Excellency Mr. Teo, together with the Defense Minister of Singapore, Mr. Ang Ang Han, the Honorable IISS Director General and Chief Executive Dr. John Chipman, Secretary General of ASEAN, the participant of Shangri-La Dialogue, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It is truly an honor and a pleasure for me to stand before you all at this fourth plenary session of the 2017 Shangri-La Dialogue and to have the opportunity to present views about finding common grounds on regional security. I would like to express my sincere gratitude and appreciation for the warm and friendly welcome from the Government of Singapore, in this instance, the Singapore Ministry of Defense, and the organizing committee of the 2017 Shangri-La Dialogue event. Indonesia affirms the importance of the Shangri-La Dialogue Forum as a media to strengthen productive, interactive communication and dialogue among participants, as well as to seek common understanding and common grounds that leads to the finding of common solution in addressing our common challenges and common threat that can undermine the peace and stability in the region. In the end, this forum is expected to be able to contribute in the making of the defense policy aiming at the realization of peace and prosperity for our people as articulated by every leader during the campaign in order to win the election. At the same time, this forum can also assist to turn uncertainty into certainty. Indonesia reiterates the need of every leader in ASEAN, together with its partner, to increase our commonalities and similarities, and at the same time, diffuse or eliminate our differences or divides that weaken our spirit of brotherhood in accordance with the strong spirit of ASEAN. With these modalities, we all can resolve any common challenges and obstruction with the peaceful spirit of ASEAN as our legacy since its establishment 50 years ago. Defense Minister, ladies and gentlemen, some modalities and commonalities that we have in the region as the foundation of our unified cooperation among members of ASEAN and its partner is the fact that we face our common factual and real threat, ranging from terrorism and radicalism, natural disaster, maritime security, robbery and theft, natural poaching, natural disease epidemic, drugs and abuse of narcotics, and cyber. In this special occasion today, I'll focus mainly on Indonesian perspective to cope with the development of the threatening global and regional threat of terrorism and militancy in our region. And ladies and gentlemen, terrorism threat in this region has evolved into unprecedented immediate level of emergency. The Daesh group's area of operation has gone global, not limited in the Middle East only. Now they have entered the strong perimeter of defense in Europe and Asia as we witness the current terror attack in Manchester, Indonesia, Egypt, and ISIS attack in Marawi, southern Philippines, currently. Based on the data of the intelligence agency in the late of 2016, the strength of ISIS was more than 31,000 fighters and 11,000 sympathizers, while in the Southeast Asia, it's estimated there are about 1,000 sympathizers. With this amount, I believe that the current strength is more. I believe it is more than 200,000. With this amount, the world has been overwhelmed, bothered, and begin appearing fear of the acts by the terrorist group. Please try to imagine Indonesia as the world's largest Muslim country of about 200 million Muslim people out of 250 million population of Indonesia. Supposing that half, 0.5% of Indonesians become sympathizer of ISIS, it means already about 1 million. It is quite a terrible number. ISIS and Daesh group's ideology is not about Islam and culture. Indonesia strongly reject and resist ISIS and will give no room to this group in Indonesia territory. Indonesia will stay steadfast and support the intelligence and information sharing and cooperation in the region to crush terrorism. Indonesia is home to the world's largest Muslim population of more than 200 million people who are a prime target for being influenced by the radicalism of the ISIS group. Based on the current survey in December 2015, indicate that 96% of Indonesians are rejected the ISIS ideology. However, 4% of the Indonesian respondents, it is about 8 million people, choose not to give the sufficient answer. In addressing the development of radicalism and ISIS, Indonesia exerts the strategy of strengthening the mindset of Indonesian people through the deep understanding of our core sincere identity rooted deep in our culture and values. As I mentioned, that 96% of Indonesia people rejected ISIS. This steadfast standing point are also reflected through the signing of the MOU that demonstrate that our commitment to fight radicalism and ISIS group, represented by the religious Islamic organization, mass organization, youth organization, that they stand to fight terrorism. With regard to the undecided respondent, 4% in our society, I believe that the sympathizers of ISIS, it is less than 700 people. However, although it is not the, we have to solve the problem to the rooted cause of the problem. Referring to a book that I read, The Future of Power by Joseph Nye, it is written that physical action using weapons and guns or hard power to crush terrorism will only contribute 1% in resolving the basic root of terrorism, while 99% solution is through soft power capability with the involvement of active role of the people in the nation by socializing the spirit of nationalism and loving the nation. What is written in the book is in line with my defense policy implemented by the Defense Minister of Indonesia. With my capacity as the Indonesian Defense Minister, I have designed a heart-based and people-oriented defense strategy, which I call the Smart Power Defense Strategy, that combine our defense diplomacy approach and capacity building through total warfare. strategy associated with strengthening the people's power, spirit, and their mindset. This strategy I call the so-called Bela Negara program, supported by our defense force capability and its armament. The tenet behind this strategy is based on our core value of respect, tolerance, and caring that reflected in our ideology of Pancasila. Ladies and gentlemen, in light of the above, I would like to take this opportunity to propose the establishment of more concrete and pragmatic concerted platform. I repeat, the concrete platform of regional cooperation and collaboration, the more broadened level of cooperation and engagement than the existing one. One of the concrete examples is the implementation of the establishment of trilateral arrangement on the Sulu waters between Indonesia, Malaysia, and the Philippines. Initially, the objective of this establishment is to fight piracy. But now, this platform has been expanded and extended to fight the development of ISIS in the region, especially in the southern Philippines. Currently, Indonesia and Malaysia are often faced with the piracy and crews taking hostage by the Abu Sayyaf radical group. Indonesia highly appreciates the government of the Philippines that has deployed its military to crack down the radical groups and to release the hostages. To address the threat to the stability, security, and peace in the region, Indonesia, Malaysia, and the Philippines have held a trilateral meeting to discuss the form of maritime cooperation that can be done for the security and safety of the ship and the people who crossing the waters in the area of our common concern. As the implementation of this maritime cooperation, the three countries signed the framework of arrangement in which the standard operating procedure on coordinated maritime patrol as one of the annexes. The three defense ministers have several times held meetings to make a collective agreement that is followed by the operational level or joint working group for finalizing the SOP related to the corridor transit, sea marshal, the establishment of joint command posts, and a major step forward would be implemented by Indonesia, Malaysia, and the Philippines. And planning for joint exercise on ground forces by the three armed forces, joint operation, and the possibility to develop trilateral cooperation involving other countries such as Thailand and Singapore. Trilateral cooperation is not only intended to prevent piracy and hostages, but also to prevent the spread of radical terrorist group in the region and other form of transnational crime. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, the key point in responding to the various form of security threats, non-traditional threat in international level, is through the mechanism of security consultation undertaken bilaterally and multilaterally, with the purpose is to resolve tension and to prevent the spread of the conflict. I believe that no single country can deal with and resolve security threats independently, not like the traditional threat, with the limitation of its capability and capacity of the country. It requires cooperation and collaboration among nations in the region to tackle any challenges. Currently, in ASEAN, we have at least three platforms of maritime cooperation ranging from joint coordinated patrol in Malacca Strait, maritime cooperation in the Gulf of Thailand, and trilateral engagement in Sulu waters. In the future, we should also consider the involvement of other countries such as Singapore, Thailand, and Vietnam, and other ASEAN countries to expand our capacity and our capability. The current strength of active military in this trilateral arrangement is around 1 million personnel, where its collaboration has covered one-third of the region of the South China Sea. With the total figures of number of population in ASEAN of 599 million people, as well as two point six million military personnel active. With these modalities, ASEAN is more ready and confident to defend its own region to maintain peace and stability in the region. I'm pretty sure of that. The second two architecture in our region interlink with the bilateral and multilateral framework with its specific role, such as the ADMM, the ASEAN Regional Forum, the East ASEAN Summit, and the informal track 1.5, such as Shangri-La Dialogue and then Malacca Strait Patrol, to tackle any threat. This forum can strengthen the security architecture in the region to move forward. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, respecting sovereignty of a nation is the key point and uncompromised. Sovereignty is uncompromised that can threaten any country. We cannot afford to interfere in other nation territorial integrity without their consent. Last but not least, before I conclude, noting the current dynamic development in our region, yet allow me to underline the importance of common understanding in addressing our common challenges, and diffuse the fight and division is imperative. And thank you so much. I thank you.